What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In this series, we'll be taking a fresh look at some of our previous content. So brace yourself for upgraded sound quality, improved animations, and a keen focus on covering any overlooked details from our initial videos. To kick things off, let's delve into the foundational concepts of object-oriented programming. As its name implies, it is a way of programming oriented towards using objects. So, to understand what object-oriented programming is, let's try to understand what an object is. In the software industry, or any other industry, humans learn by observing the nature around them, and try to make the industry's thinking closer to the real world. So, let's think about a real-life object, like an apple for example. Is an apple an object? Of course it is. What about a laptop or a car? Sure. Now, what if we had another apple, same color, brought from the same country, same town, but still we know that this apple is different from the first one because each apple has its own identity. The same applies for the objects in a computer program. Each object has its own identity. Even if we have multiple instances of this object, it doesn't mean that all of them refer to the same object. Laptops can have multiple brands, come in multiple colors. These are attributes that relate to this specific laptop. Other laptops can have the same brand or the same color, but still they're different laptops. A laptop can be on or off, can open a program or close it. These are behaviors specific to a laptop. An apple cannot behave as such, but all laptops can. Now, while in the real world we tend to use only concrete things to be referred to as objects, in OOP this can go further to include abstractions such as bank accounts, dates, or events. All of these are well-defined ideas having their own identities separate from each other, their own attributes, information that describes their current state, and their own behaviors, things they can do. But how are these objects created in OOP? To answer this question, we will need to explore a new keyword at the base of all coding in object-oriented programming, and it's class. We use classes to create objects, so a class describes what the object will be, but it isn't the object itself, nor a collection of objects. A class is a blueprint for an object, a definition. If we want to build a car before assembling the parts, we draw a schema first, a blueprint describing everything about how that car will be built. But it isn't the car itself. We then use that blueprint to build 1 or 1,000 cars. We define the class once and then instantiate 1,000 objects based on that class. We must write the blueprint or the class in the first place. Let's say our application deals with books. We will create a book class with a title attribute. The class does not say what the title of the book is, it just says that the book created using this class will have a title. It is just providing the definition. Then using this class, we can go ahead and create book objects and give them the titles we want. Each one will have its own identity and a title independent from other objects. When we create a class, we ignore the irrelevant, the unimportant, and focus on the essential qualities of something rather than sticking to one specific example that illustrates our idea or a piece of information. And that in OOP is referred to as abstraction. Abstraction is hiding the details, and later on, after defining the abstraction or the definition, concreteness will be built upon it. The result of the abstraction is a blueprint or a class to follow while creating an object. In other words, we can say that an object is abstracted into a class. Another thing we do while creating a class is take this information that describes our object, which are the attributes, and the things it can do, the behaviors, and encapsulate them, containerize them in the same unit, the same class. And this in object-oriented programming is referred to as encapsulation. Encapsulation is not only about encapsulating the attributes and behaviors to keep them together, but also to protect them and to restrict access to the inner workings of any object based on that class to the outside world. The point is, an object should not reveal anything about itself except what is mandatory for other parts of the application to work. Let's suppose we have a bank account class with a balance attribute and a deposit method. We don't want any external source to access the balance attribute and change it without going through the deposit method, because you see in this method, we are applying an interest rate, or we are applying some currency conversion factors before actually updating this value. Okay, now as a next step for this banking application, we would like to create an employee class to use it later on and generate objects representing each employee in the bank. But while creating the employee class, we realized it contains the same attributes as the person class, a class that already exists in our application and is being used by other parts of it. Now, because we want to use abstraction and don't want to add the salary to the person class and use it, as not every object created using the person class will have a salary, what we are going to do is stick to creating the employee class, add to it the salary, and inherit the attributes of the person class because an employee is a person. And this in OOP is referred to as inheritance. All changes made to the parent class or super class will be automatically reflected and passed down to the child class or subclass. In OOP, inheritance is also referred to as generalization and uses an is-a relationship from a specialized class to a more general class. In our example, person is the generalization of employee. So far, inheritance was only associated with the attributes of a class. But what about its behaviors? The child class will also inherit all its parent's class behaviors. If we need them as is, we are fine. And if we need to add behaviors on top of the ones present in the parent class, we just add them to the child class as we did with the salary attribute. But what if we need to change the behaviors inherited from the parent class? What if we need to override a particular behavior with another one? Object-oriented programming allows us to do so, and this goes by overriding. When child classes override behaviors present in their parent classes, these behaviors are prioritized and are executed instead of the ones present in the parent class. Okay, let's suppose we have a list of person objects, and based on what we just learned, an employee is also a person. So, the list may contain person objects as well as employee objects. Now, if we randomly select an object from this list and invoke an overridden behavior, will it use the implementation written in the person or employee class? Well, it depends on the class. If it is a plain person object, then it will use the implementation written in the person class. And if it is an employee object, it will use the one written in the employee class, which is the more specialized behavior. This is transparent to the user, and in object-oriented programming is referred to as polymorphism. As its name suggests, it can translate into many forms, so it automatically does the correct behavior, even if what we are dealing with can take one of many forms, like the person class in this case. Another example we use every day is the plus sign. What does it do? Well, it depends. In many programming languages, if we are dealing with numbers, the plus sign will add them and give us the sum result. But if we are dealing with letters or strings, it will concatenate them. This also applies to our own custom class and objects. Even if the person class becomes a parent class to a customer class, employee class, and student class, and the method is overridden by all these classes, when objects are creating using all these classes and are put inside the same list, the correct specialized behavior will always be called when this list is traversed. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.